गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरु साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः We are in Amrit Anubhav, Chapter 2, Sri Gurustavana, OV number 30. And we are looking at the question that Jnaneshwar Maharaj put was, how the Guru Maharaj does not accept even the slightest trace of duality in the disciple, even by mistake, is now explained. So, kahi bahi alumala dekhe ekha devela tari dekhe tehi vitala jaya gavi. when one wants to objectify the self, that is the guru, even for a short while, the distinction of the seer and the seen disappears, because in his abode, duality is unacceptable. So, what is this? What does this mean? When the awareer becomes aware of itself, when consciousness that I am become conscious, make an attempt to be conscious of myself. The I tries to know itself. That is this Gyan Mudra. The I wanting to know itself. In that attempt, this thing happens. What? The distinction of the seer and the seen vanishes. Because in this abode, in this final substratum, in this, the duality is unacceptable. It is one without a second, where multiplicity, duality is absent in toto. Not even an iota is possible. Not even an iota of duality is possible there. Even after understanding the truth as explained above, the disciple still continues to regard the Guru Tattva with name and form, even if it is only a rare mistake. This is with the obsession. It is only the obsession of continuing to accept the Guru as name and form is because we have accepted ourselves as name and form. And as long as we keep making that mistake, we will be far away from the Guru Tattva. And that was the meditation today, that how the ornament is already the gold. So how can it realize gold when it is already gold? Think. The wave is already water. So how can it realize water? Wave is not separate to water. See? Exactly the same way. The consciousness that I am is already the infinite consciousness. But your obsession with the form is creating a distinct identity as if. and you cannot drop this. This you cannot drop. Then what can we do? Just like when we look at the ocean and we look at the wave, we know the wave is already the ocean. Wave is already the water. The ornament is already the gold. Same way, we have to accept that we are already the infinite and start looking at everything from the infinite standpoint. Take the ocean standpoint, if the intermediate stage. We are taking the individual standpoint and wanting to merge, wanting to do sadhana, wanting to do exercises, pranayama, this, blah, 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 blah. And the premise of that is that I am separate from the destination, that infinite consciousness is an object to be achieved, is an experience to be had. I want to become infinite consciousness. Right now I am individual. Can the wave become water? If in your minds the answer is no, it is already water, then why this foolish search to realize? Accept that you are the infinite consciousness. That's all the shift that is required. The intensity with which we have accepted the names and forms to be real, with the say that incentive intensity directed towards the infinite. And everything will stop. And you do it. Every night you do it. Every night you do it. Without your efforts, the whole world of name and form gets deleted from your mind, even though temporarily, but it gets deleted. Because you gave your whole soul to sleep. You are totally focused on sleep. Here you be totally focused on the infinite. Unlike sleep, which is an experience, the waker cannot enter into sleep. Here the consciousness that I am is the infinite consciousness. So start looking at everything from the total consciousness or the infinite consciousness point of view. What will be the waves approach, individual approach? That there be, everything is separate to me, that I was born, I will die, etc., etc. What will be the total consciousness? That all the individual consciousnesses are a part of me. I am alone pervading all the individual consciousnesses, individuals. They are not separate from me. Therefore, there will be no desire for the other. There will be no desire for any object or being. Why? You are already that. The disciple still continues to regard the Guru Tattva with name and form, even if it is only a rare mistake that slips, wipes out all his past efforts. This one unforgivable mistake is the persistence of duality in the disciple's vision. Default settings. This is like that in the snake and the ladder, the 99, the snake is waiting. And what is that snake? The one who brings you back to zero. So if we allow one thought to come and hijack our attention, that very moment we have fallen from our essential nature. Can we stop thoughts? No, we cannot stop thoughts. And don't even try to do that. Because if we try to stop our thoughts, they will take revenge. They will come back with more vengeance. What we want to bring about is a condition, a disposition wherein the thoughts may come or may not come. We are not affected by them. We get affected by them only by giving them value, by giving them importance, by accepting that they are. But when we take the position of the infinite or the total, then what is happening? Then we have automatically, like the ocean does not love or hate any wave because it alone is. Same will be our condition. We will not love or hate any thought of anything in this creation. Because everything I am pervading the whole. This one unforgivable mistake is the persistence of duality in the disciple's vision. This is the worst impurity in the kingdom of the Guru Maharaj. In that kingdom, entry of duality is not allowed. In the kingdom of Guru Maharaj, in the kingdom of Guru Tattva, that infinite truth, duality is the impurity. It is an erroneous approach to objectify the Guru as someone other than oneself. See, Swamiji says it is an erroneous approach to objectify. And what is happening in the world? Look around. Guru Maharaj ki jai. Cults are getting formed in the name of Guru. The organizations are in the name of the Guru. But what they have taught, that nobody is following. They are following the form. So let us not be succumbing to that mistake. It is an erroneous approach to objectify the Guru as someone other than oneself. In him, there is no trace of duality. Such objectification is the biggest obstacle in one's spiritual unfoldment. And this is called objectification of the reality, objectification of the self. When we are thinking of the self as an idea, when we are thinking of the self as a thought, as a concept, as an object, like I am looking at myself in the screen as an object of experience. But where is my attention here when I'm looking there? When I'm looking in the screen, have I fallen to such an extent that I start thinking that reflection in the screen is the real one? Or I look at the screen, and I know that, okay, if the screen is there and the camera is on, I will come on the screen. But the true one is here. See? Objectification means we are lost in the screen of the mind. We are lost in the thoughts. We are lost in thinking about the truth rather than being the truth. Because for us, knowledge means thinking. For us, knowledge means thinking. collection of thoughts, collection of ideas, collection of concepts. Oh, that was beautiful what Swamiji has written. Oh, it was beautiful what Jnaneshwar Maharaj has written. It's still objective. It's still objective. And as long as it is objective, you are not having the disposition of the ocean that I alone am pervading all the waves. Are you having this disposition that I alone am pervading all the verses of the scriptures? I alone am pervading all that there is in this universe. Are we having that disposition? Or at least attempting that? No. We keep the universe separate from ourselves. We keep the scripture separate from ourselves. Same way, we keep the truth also separate from ourselves by thinking about it, by way of thought. And that brings about the duality. And such objectification is the biggest obstacle in one's spiritual unfoldment. Actually speaking, there is nothing to unfold. Actually speaking, there is nothing to unfold. Then what is required? Enfold. The mind has to collapse. Mind has to collapse. And the self is always there. Self is not to be unfolded. Self is ever. The only obstacle, the only reason that self is not being experienced as the only one is on account of, or our obsession of, or overthinking is due to overthinking. Stop the thinking, and thinking can stop only when we are contemplating on that which cannot be contemplated upon. So bring yourself to that point. If that be so, then how does one differ, how does one offer salutations to the Guru Maharaj? Because we saw in the previous verse, 28-29, that Jnaneshwar Maharaj was tired of speaking so many words, and he says, enough of all these examples and this and that. So now the question is, then how does one offer salutations to the Guru? He says, Te the namane ka bole, ke uti suye paule, anga lalauni na dile, na vachiyene. It says, such being the case, in what way can the salutations be offered or words of praise be said? In the absence of any form, the name has lost its significance. See, understand one thing, that one truth, we keep saying, no, he is the material cause of the creation and he is the efficient cause of the creation. We keep saying that. So how is he expressing? How that one reality, that one consciousness, how is it expressing as the universe? It's expressing in the universe, permeating the universe as name and form. Where is form? Outside of you. Where is the name? Is it outside or inside? It is inside. It is in our mouth, in our mind. You cannot have it the other way. You cannot have the name outside and the form inside. Nope. So that one truth alone is expressing as name and form. Form is out there and the name is in our mind. Can you do anything about the form outside? Can you control the form? Can you destroy the form? You did not create it. So how can you destroy it? Even if you try to destroy it, you can't destroy all the forms. Because that is not your jurisdiction. That is not the area that you can influence. You got no power over the form. But yes, you have the power over the name. Because my name is in your mind. And you can choose whether to take the name or not to take the name. Whether to call out something or not to call out something. Whether to think or not to think is your choice. You can do something about the name. See? So choose such name which indicates the transcendence, which indicates the transcendental reality. In the absence of any form, the name has also lost its significance. If I, when Swamiji, he's taking the stories of the saints. In one of the stories, it was that one disciple was there and his Guru Maharaj took him for 11 years. He locked him up in a cave. And for 11 years, he served his disciple by preparing two meals a day and feeding him. 11 years. And that disciple who was in the cave, he had not seen sun for 11 years. But he knew and had faith that whatever his Guru Maharaj is doing is only for his benefit. Through the door, the teacher will keep guiding his mind, telling him, do this exercise, do that exercise, do this sadhana, think in this manner, think in that manner. His mind was not allowed to expose to the world. When the mind was not allowed to expose to the world over a period of time, it loses interest in the world because it is not getting the nutrition of the world. And we are continuously exposed, continuously seeking the nutrition of the name as well as the form. That's why we want to come to meditation. Why? At least our eyes are closed and the form is missing. That's why we go to sleep. Why? Because the form is missing from our mind. Because the moment eyes fall on some form, then the desire arises that what is the name of this form? Where did it come from? When was it born? Who created it? What are its qualities? How you can use it? See, so many things begin. Form is one, but you interact with that one form as wife, another one interacts with that one form as mother, another interacts with that one form as sister. Form is one. Similarly, this entire creation is nothing but one, but everyone is interacting with that one as they feel like. Because we have conditioned ourselves. See? And we can transcend this form only when we are contemplating on the formless. Since objectification of the guru is impossible, what words of praise can be spoken, and in what way can one offer salutations to the Guru Maharaj? Furthermore, the Guru Maharaj is not limited by any name and form, and since he is not a personality, how can he be given a name like Nivrittinatha? See? So who is the Guru? So for us, Guru means the one with the form. So we already lost the plot. See, it's that simple. The way we interact with the world, we are choosing and using those parameters to interact with the Guru Maharaj also. And if we interact with him, with the Guru Maharaj in that, with the same parameters, we are continuing to expose ourselves to duality. And as long as we are in duality, that unifying experience, less experience is never possible. So here, the Guru Maharaj is not limited by any name and form. So who is Guru Maharaj? What is the Guru Tattva within? What is this true self? That which is supporting all the names and forms, but itself not affected by any name and form, transcendental to name and form, from the truth, reality point of view. There is no name and form because only one exists, and that I am. Name and form, the duality, happens only when I forget that I am the reality. See? He is not a personality. The Guru Tattva or Guru Maharaj is not a personality. Then how can he be given a name, Nivrittinatha? This was the meditation today. How can we realize? There is nothing called realization. How can the wave realize the waters? It is already the water. How can the wave realize the ocean? It is already the ocean. How can the ornament realize the gold? It is already the gold. Then where is the question of realization then? You have to just accept. Instead of accepting yourself to be the form, you have to accept yourself as the underlying principle, which is without form. Just acceptance. We are looking from the down, we are looking up. All you have to do is change the position. Go up and look down. Story over. When you look down on the various roles of father, brother, husband, then roles become important and all the problems and challenges are for the roles. But the moment you take a higher position, what is the higher position? What is that one which is supporting all the roles? The man. The moment you come to being the man, all the issues of all the roles slowly start disappearing. The mind becomes calm. Then the roles do not hijack the man, because man knows he is the one who is expressing through the roles. Roles are only imaginary, they are only projections. And it is the projections which are miserable or excited. Man is neutral. Man is not attached to any one role, because he has to, all the roles, depending upon the situation, they come up and then they go back. Again they come up, again they go back. Exactly the same way. You take the position, the higher position. Take the position of the ocean. or take the position of the water. Then you will see that all the names and forms, I alone am. No more obsession. Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj, Guru Maharaj. See? Then this objectification, seeing the Guru as an idea, as a concept, as a form, this will go out of your system. In this way, when the disciple wants to salute the Guru, the self, the duality disappears. How does the disciple salute the Guru, the self? By contemplating on the self. By being the self. The duality disappears and oneness is discovered. That oneness is covered by duality. And when that mind, which is nothing but duality, thinks about the unifying principle, thinks about the substratum, when we use the word in some places, they use the word mindfulness. Mindfulness doesn't mean to be mindful of the thoughts. Mindful means to be aware of the substratum on which the thoughts are coming and going. So when we say be aware of your mind, be conscious, you are conscious of the thoughts. And we lose the plot. Because again our attention is going to name and form. We didn't give the instruction. Nowhere in the scriptures they are saying be aware of the thoughts. No. Be aware of the mind. Be conscious of the mind. But instead we become conscious of the thoughts. Mind is the substratum. Mind is the foundation. Mind is the common denominator on which the various thoughts are coming and going. See, suddenly the whole disposition is shifted. If you think of the thoughts, you will feel, oh, I am losing my mind. If the thoughts are going away, you will feel, I am becoming forgetful. I am losing my memory. I am not able to come up with the right words at the right time. But if your attention is on the mind, who cares whether the thoughts are there or not? Then this feeling that I am having dementia, that I am losing my mind, I am losing my memory, all these ideas will not come in your mind only, because your attention is on the mind itself, on the consciousness itself. Mind is nothing but consciousness. See, the duality disappears and oneness is discovered. The oneness which is not an opponent of two-ness. It is one without a second. And this you can contemplate, this you can be even right now. This oneness is not opposed to duality. What ocean is not opposed to waves, that I can be the one ocean only when all the waves have disappeared. This is what we say, no? Chitta vritti nirodaha iti yogaha. When all the thoughts have subsided and dissolved, then I am going to be in samadhi. Initial stages, this is okay. Ocean doesn't say that all the waves need to be destroyed in order for me to be complete. He is complete in spite of all the waves. Do you have this disposition about yourself? That I am complete, that I am infinite, in spite of the duality? A big shift. So what is this truth? What is this self? This self is one without a second, ever absorbed in itself, self-knowing, self-effulgent, self-conscious, and it is not opposed to the phenomena. And what is the phenomena? The duality, the mind. It is not opposed to phenomena. Phenomena will continue. Realized masters go through the waking, dream, deep sleep. Phenomena continues. They also feel hungry. So here that is, Jnaneshwar Maharaj is saying that the disciple wants to salute the guru, the self, when he wishes, this is the salute. When he wishes to salute the self with the I, that I am, I have disconnected with the body, gross body, subtle body, causal body. I have come to the I, and I is now contemplating on its own source, on its own self. That is the salute that is being talked about here. Because this finger has merged into the substratum, the I has merged into the substratum, meaning recognized its true nature. Before, the I was recognizing itself through these. Now, this I is recognizing itself as it is, one without a second. And once it has done that, does it need to remove? Will it have a thought that I must remove the gross, subtle and causal? I must remove the waking, dream and deep sleep? No, when he has come to know his real nature, the I, then he alone is everywhere. Then this idea that I have to fight against something, that I am impure, that I have to escape from this duality, all these ideas will be null and void. See, so this oneness is not in opposition to two-ness, the duality. It is one without a second, ekameva dvitiya. This absorption into one's own essential nature, where silence is the praise, where duality is absent, this is the true salutation. Silence does not mean non-appearance of thoughts. Silence does not mean taking the world and plucking it out of the mind. No. Silence means when this world of names and forms is unable to affect you. It's unable to invoke a reaction out of you. And doesn't this happen when you are focused on some job, when you are preparing for exam, when you are doing an operation? So many things are going on around, but you are absolutely oblivious of everything because you are focused. Same way. So this absorption into one's essential nature, where silence is the praise. It is the eloquent silence. It is conscious silence. It is not inert silence. It is not dead silence. It is conscious silence. And that consciousness I am. And this consciousness, which is one without a second, which is the substratum, which is the common denominator, only when we are not buffeted by the duality of the world, then we can access our essence, access our true nature. Once we have accessed, from that moment onwards, the world is there or not there, it does not matter to us, matter to this person. Once he has recognized the Guru Tattva as the Self, then it does not matter. Anything does not matter. Such a person becomes fearless. This thought is continued further in the next OV. Nahi atmaya atma pravritti vadhavita ke nivritti ya nama chivaya buddhi sandhi china. In fact, the Self does not have any involvement, pravritti. How can there be absence of involvement, nivritti? Although it is so, he holds the name nivritti to mean that he is beyond both pravritti and nivritti. So beautiful. Pravritti means involvement. Nivritti means withdrawal. Isn't it? Waking and dream means involvement. Deep sleep means withdrawal. And it is being told, this Self is it expresses in life in two ways, pravritti and nivritti. It gets involved and it gets withdrawn. At a total level, waking and dream and deep sleep. On the daily level, right now also, you are involved when the word strikes your eardrums and a thought is formed, and it withdraws when there is silence between two words. So we are lost in this involvement withdrawal, involvement withdrawal, involvement withdrawal. Oh, this is the truth. I got involved with my wife, then I withdrew from my wife. Then I involved with my children, then I withdraw from the children. Then I get involved with my husband, then I withdraw from the husband. I get involved with my friends, I withdraw. And this is what is going on. This is what is phenomena. This is not real. The one who has come to this silence, conscious silence, one he who has come to abide in the Self as the Self, that very moment it will come to know that it is, everything is itself alone. Then where is the question of involvement and withdrawal? Is the ocean saying that I have to involve pravritti and become a wave? Now I have to withdraw nivritti to become ocean again? No, because from ocean's point of view, it is all that there is. Even if it is looking at waves, it never feels that wave are separate to him. And if there is nothing called separate to him, there is no need for an eruption of thought. So from ocean's point of view, the thought called wave does not come. How many times you think about your eyes or nose or hands or fingers or legs? How many times do you think? Because you think you are it. But the moment there is a problem, then you start thinking about it. Ocean doesn't think. Because it is all pervasive. And when we use the word all pervasive, it is with respect to the waves. But from ocean's point of view, it alone is. So there is no pravritti of thoughts called waves and no nivritti of the ocean from the waves to realize that it is the infinite ocean and not the wave. But we stupid fools who consider ourselves to be wave, we keep thinking, oh, I have to withdraw and come to realize the infinite one. So his guru's name, Jnaneshwar Maharaj's guru name is, elder brother's name is Nivritti Natha. Nivritti means withdrawal. So here the withdrawal is not that withdrawal which is from involvement. Here he says, he holds the name Nivritti to mean that he is beyond Pravritti and Nivritti. He is the ever withdrawn. He is the one who is beyond involvement and withdrawal. See? It is wrong on our part to attribute to totality, to the gods, like the ocean. That why you are making my life difficult, please help me realize, please fulfill my wishes. It is wrong. It shows how strong the ego is. It shows how still we are attracted to the phenomenal world. And out of that attraction to the phenomenal world, we are ready to take the substratum and use it, request it, propitiate it to satisfy our desires for this phenomenal world, which is existing in its own absence. So wave is praying to the ocean, please remove that tsunami, it is coming to kill me. It's like that, we are praying to the gods, please make this wish come true, make that wish come true, make this happen, make that happen. We have lost the plot. There seems to be an apparent ambivalence in the disciple's approach towards the Guru. On one hand, he considers the Guru as Advaita Tattva, then he wants to give salutations to him as if he is an object of salutation, then he says he has no name, and yet he calls him Nivritti Natha. In the Absolute, there is neither Pravritti, involvement, nor Nivritti, withdrawal. The contradiction pointed out above is only seemingly so. In reality, the Guru, the Paramatma Tattva, is holding on to the name, to this name, only to indicate that he is beyond the limitation of both Pravritti and Nivritti. Who is calling him Nivritti Nath? Is Nivritti calling himself Nivritti? Or is it Jnaneshwar Maharaj or the society which has given him the name, the parents who have given him the name, are calling him Nivritti? So when we were given the name Swami Paramananda, so did I call myself the name, was I born with the name that at the time of this body came into existence? No, parents gave the name, then went to ashram, then the guru, the teacher there gave us the name, then came sannyas, again another name was given. Everyone keeps giving us name. Someone calls us a brother, someone calls us a son, someone calls us something else. But can the self be called by any name? Even the word self that is used is only to so that our attention doesn't go to not self. That's all. So when we say the word Paramanand, infinite bliss, the word Paramanand is to indicate that you are essentially beyond all joys and sorrows. You are infinite bliss. So don't come down to the level of joys and sorrows. Don't come down to the level of likes and dislikes. Don't come down to the level of attachment, detachment. Don't come down to the level of I am bound and now I want to be free. See, this we have to recognize about our own essential nature, which we are always. There has never been a time we are not the self. So what is this self? Which is never bound, therefore it can never be free. With respect to bondage, then what is its nature? It's transcendental. It is swatantra. It is ever free in that sense. Ever free means it is free from the bondage and freedom. This idea of bondage and freedom has gone out of the self. It's beyond it. It's beyond attachment and detachment. But the phenomenon of attachment and detachment will continue. But the self is ever free, supporting everything, permeating everything. So the Paramatma Tattva is holding on to this name, whatever the name you have given to that, only to indicate that he is beyond the limitation of both pravritti and nivritti. Here the case is Nivrittinath. So he is holding on to the name only to indicate he is beyond the involvement and withdrawal. So you also have a name. It has a meaning. I hope it's not Tom and Jerry or Mickey Mouse. So on one hand, the student accepts the Guru Tattva as independent of name and form, it is the substratum. And on the other hand, the mind wants to salute the Guru Tattva, who is the substratum, as if he is an object of salutation. And then on one hand he says that the Guru Tattva is beyond names and forms, it has got no name. And then on the other hand, the same mind says it is Nivrittinatha. And to address this, that this is where our condition is. On one hand, we are being told that the self is the substratum. It is one without a second. It is beyond all names and forms. And on the other hand, we are being told it is Nitya, Shuddha, Buddha, Mukta, it was Ekameva, Dvitiya. It is Brahman, it is Atma, it is Paramatma. It is Paramananda, Anubhavananda, Shivananda. So many different names are being given. to sort this out, this idea was given. And this is the conundrum that we will come to if our attention is on the substratum, on the self. Furthermore, nivartyatava nahi ma nivartavi kaha kai tari kaisa baise thai nivritti namacha. If he, Guru Nivrittinath, has nothing to negate due to the absence of otherness, what does he remove? If this is the doubt, what is indicated by the word Nivritti? May the listeners be attentive. See, the student is, the Jnaneshwar Maharaj is preempting the question that might arise in our mind. The word Nivritti means withdrawal. And if you are saying, Jnaneshwar Maharaj, if you are saying that Nivritti is beyond the Pravritti and Nivritti, he is beyond, so there is nothing to withdraw from, then why has he got the name Nivrittinath? What is he trying to withdraw from? If he is transcendental to involvement and withdrawal, if this is the doubt, what is indicated by the word Nivritti? That Jnaneshwar Maharaj says, my Guru Maharaj is called Nivritti, although he is not rejecting or negating anything. There being no duality in the Guru, there is nothing to negate. Such being the case, why is he called Nivritti? This doubt might come. He is loudly thinking, who? Jnaneshwar Maharaj. As he is writing these verses down, it's loud contemplation. He himself is asking the question. His mind himself is asking the question. This is reflection going. The doubt has come. He is going to remove it. And where is he removing it from? By his own contemplation. How do we remove? We get more confused. We complicate things. My Guru Maharaj is Nivritti and Nivritti. This Guru Maharaj has nothing to negate. Because he is the one without a second. Such being the case, why is he called Nivritti? Sant Jnaneshwar Maharaj explains this through a unique example. And he gives here the example. Pari suryasi andhakara kaizhala hota gochara tarhi tamari ha dagara alachi ki. Did the seven sun ever see the face of darkness? Did the sun ever see the face of darkness? Even then he is named as enemy of darkness. There you go. Has the sun ever seen darkness or fought with and killed darkness? A question is asked. The sun will never not even understand what darkness is, or for that matter, what light is. And yet the sun is called Tamari, the enemy of Ari. Ari means Tama is darkness, Ari means enemy of darkness. Just as Shiva is called Kamari, the enemy of desire, the Kama. Lord Rama is called Kharari, the enemy of demons Khara and Dushana. In the case of Lord Shiva and Lord Rama, the enemy was in front of them, opposing them. Whereas in the case of the Lord Sun, he is not in opposition to any enemy called darkness. He is not in opposition to any enemy called darkness. From Sun's point of view, there is nothing called darkness. From sun's point of view, there is nothing called light also. from the reality point of view, there is nothing called a self or not self. We are using the word self only because there is something which comes and goes, which is called not self. We are using the word reality only because there is unreality. We are using the word existence only because our attention is on the non-existing or temporary existing things. But the truth, the Atma, the Self, doesn't need any name. It is as it is by itself. Whatever it may be called is the abstract one. The mind cannot conceptualize it. But when we use the word, it becomes a concept. So for the sun, there is nothing called darkness. So can he be called, he has removed the darkness, he has killed the darkness? So also the Guru Maharaj Nivrittinath is not in opposition to anything, because nothing else exists. Understand this. Apart from the water ocean standpoint, nothing apart from the ocean exists. There is nothing called wave, there is nothing called droplets, there is nothing called froth, nothing called tsunami. It is all that there is. This is stated in the next OV, that it is not in opposition to anything. Tai se latike yene rudhe zadab yene ujivade na ghade te hi ghade jaya chiya mava. He says, in the same way, by his inherent power, he makes things that are not. The inert becomes enlivened, and even the impossible can happen due to his maya. What is this maya? The inherent potential within that one without a second principle, which is the self. There is infinite potential. And that infinite potential, which is expressing as this creation, is not to give us trouble. Individual things, this is a big trouble. No, it is not. It is out of joy. The Guru is called Nivrittinath only by tradition and just for the sake of it. Just for the sake of it. All names given to the truth, even the word truth, self, Brahman, Paramatma, are just for the sake of it. Nivritti does not mean that the Guru is the opponent of Pravritti, because the word Nivritti means withdrawal. Don't come to this conclusion that he is against involvement. He cares a hoot with regards to involvement and withdrawal. Who is that? Your eyes are blinking. When they open, you are involved in the forms. When they close, when they blink, you are withdrawn from all the forms. Is this not happening every moment right now? Are you opposed to it? No. My eyes should not. I will not allow them to open because too many forms are coming in. Are you opposed to it? It's a natural phenomenon. It is going on. it owned that phenomena becomes a problem when you get attached to something, then it becomes a problem. See? Otherwise, you are you and the phenomena is going on, the eyes are going on. Eyes are doing what they are supposed to do, the senses are doing what they are supposed to do. Same way, the mind is doing what it is supposed to do. When it gets involved, waking and dream, when it withdraws deep sleep, let it continue. Don't get attached to involvement or withdrawal. If you get attached, then you become the waker, you become the dreamer. And when you become attached, oh, this was too hard, now I want rest, you become the sleeper. No, you are the one. Don't get involved to this waking dream and deep sleep. Waking dream and deep sleep is nothing but pravritti and nivritti, involvement and withdrawal. Atma is beyond it. Without Atma, this mind cannot go through this flux, through this throb of involvement and withdrawal. And what is this mind? It is the potential of the self. Self with thoughts is called the mind. Consciousness with thoughts is called the mind. You remain conscious of consciousness. Story over. Why do you get attracted, get attached, get involved in the thoughts? Don't. If the thoughts come, let them come. If they go away, let them go away. And this is your experience. I gave the example with your eyes. We have given the value in the wrong place. That's why we are getting buffeted by the... That's why we want liberation. That's why we feel bound. The real meaning here is he in whom there is nirvritti jnanam. Nir means without, vritti means thought, jnanam means knowledge. He who is the thought free knowledge is nivritti natha. Again, thought free knowledge does not mean thought should come or not come. You are not influenced by them. That is, there is absence of aham vritti or idam vritti. Therefore, means the pure consciousness. He who is aham vritti, owner, the doer, he doesn't become the doer or the owner of anything. Idam vritti, anything that you own. So this consciousness itself divides itself into two. What is that? Aham and idam. Man itself divides himself into two, the son and the husband. But is this, can you see two people? Or is it an imagination of two on the one? Exactly the same way. This consciousness as if divides into two. The moment it divides into two, it is called the mind. And what are the two? Before we talked about by name, way of name and form, now here it is told as aham and idam. Aham is one, idam are many. Idam means that, other than I. And this guru has the inherent power to enliven the inert, and what is impossible can also happen because of him. See, isn't this consciousness that I am enlivening all the inert bodies in the dream? It It's giving birth to the bodies, it is maintaining them, it destroys them. Not in this potentiality, in this mind, in this Guru Tattva, nothing is impossible. Nothing is impossible. Because it is all that there is, and it has the infinite potentiality. So here he says, first he says that Guru Nivrittinath is the thought-free knowledge, and thought-free, which are the thoughts that he has become, gone beyond the thought of aham and idam. And aham and idam are not, just like water itself has become the two waves, the consciousness itself has become the two waves, the wave of I and the wave of that. And when then two waves collide with each other, again two more waves are created, or maybe three more waves are created, and this keeps, and eventually there are so many waves in the water. Exactly the same. But this, who is this Guru Maharaj? Nirvritti Jnanam, thought-free knowledge. He is not depending on the thoughts for knowledge. He has come to realize he is the knowledge. His essence is the knowledge. His nature is the knowledge. Now he is not thinking. When we come to this stage, he is not thinking. Then what is he doing? He is being. Wherever there is a thought, you are doing, you are trying, you are putting efforts. But where there are no thoughts, you are being. And this Guru, this being, this Paramatma, Nivritti Nath, this Atma, this Guru has the inherent power to enliven the inert. And what is impossible can also happen. And this we see in Guru. If you read the biographies of various masters, they can heal a person, they can make a dead person alive, they can make rain happen. There's so many things they can do. Where does this power come from? From their own inherent potential. It has not come from outside. It is not magic. And who can wield this power? Who can make this impossible become possible? Only he who has come to recognize that all, I am all that there is. What is impossible can also happen because of him, and his power of delusion is so great that all the impossible things can happen in his kingdom. So this Maya, here word used is delusion, you take it in the positive way. It is the Radha, it is the Sita, it is the Gauri. It is the inherent power of the Guru Maharaj. That it can make impossible things happen. And therefore we must seek the blessings of the Mata, Devi Mata. Don't go against your mind, don't fight with your mind. That mind is the Devi, it is the Shakti, which is the inherent power of the reality. And in this way, come to understand the disposition of Jnaneshwar Maharaj towards his Guru Maharaj, towards the Guru. Now Sant Jnaneshwara addresses the Guru Maharaj directly and confesses his helplessness in comprehending the Guru Tattva, the support of all entities, but which does not require any support. We'll just read this little bit and then conclude. He says, Ha ka maya vashe davisi, te mai ka manoni valisi, amai ka tava navasi, kavana hi visho. O Guru Maharaj, whatever you show through your maya is advised to be discarded, being the product of maya, and you being beyond maya cannot be comprehended by any means. In other words, whatever is changing must be discarded. That which is unchanging must continue to hold on to that, continue to contemplate on that. See? O Guru Maharaj, you keep advising that this world is your glory, is not the reality. It is only your maya. It is only a manifestation of limited knowledge, and all that which is included in the perception through limitation of the means of knowledge is not the truth. So you admonish us and tell us to reject it and go beyond the limitations. You only first tell us that go beyond the maya, go beyond the changing, go beyond the limitations, go beyond the conditionings. Don't give too much value to the ephemeral. Give value to the unchanging principle. You only tell us that. In vritti jnanam, that is knowledge through the medium of thought, there is thought replacement of one thought of ignorance by another one of knowledge. This is what we did in meditation today. Either you take the position of individuality, your choice, or you take the position of the all-inclusivity, your choice. Because, as we explained, the ocean, the totality, and wave, the individuality, is nothing but one. They are not separate. So if you, the consciousness, if the you consider yourself to be individual consciousness and you want to seek and realize the infinite consciousness, they are already one. Question is, where is your attention? Are you thinking, even when you are seeking the infinite consciousness, when you seek the infinite consciousness, you have taken the position of individual consciousness, with the presumption that you are not the infinite one. Think. That's why you're seeking. That's why you want realization. Take the position of the infinite or the total. Seeking will stop. Where seeking stops, that is called realization. That is called meditation. That is called abidance. Seeking must stop. And as long as we are individual, only we can do is seeking. When will we stop then? For the seeking to stop, for the thoughts to stop, for the efforts to stop, for the desire to realize to stop, you have to shift your position. And this is being explained here in vritti jnanam, in thought knowledge. Knowledge through the medium of thought, there is thought replacement of one thought of ignorance by the other of knowledge. When we are at the level of mind, which is nothing but thoughts, a seeker is told, this is ignorance and it is replaced by knowledge. Knowledge of the world initially, knowledge of the changing is called ignorance, and knowledge of the thought of the self is called knowledge. And afterwards, even this thought has to be given up. This is a conceptual replacement of thought. You cannot remove a thought by some physical act. You need you need a similar treatment. So just like we have a virus, we get affected by, so we go and take a injection, flu injection. What is that flu injection? That flu injection is containing the same virus which is injected into our body. So if I got typhoid, then I have to be injected with that only. I cannot be injected with smallpox injection. So in this manner, this is a conceptual replacement of thought. So thought can be replaced only by a thought. But the truth is beyond the concepts. So we are not talking here about continuous. See, when we take the name of the Lord, what you are doing? We are replacing the thoughts of the world by the thought of the God's name. But we have to go beyond. So, Vaikhari Madhyama Pashyanti Para. When we come to Para, we are still in the mind, but we have gone beyond the three expressions of the thought, gross, subtle and causal. But we are still in the realm of transcendental thought. We are still not merged. We have not gone beyond it yet. But the truth is beyond concepts and therefore cannot be grasped by concepts of what it is and what it is not. You cannot conceptualize the truth. And thoughts are only concepts. Thoughts are only ideas. Thought is incapable because it is changing. It is limited. It appears only for a moment in our mind. And therefore that which appears only for a moment, even if that thought is called a reality, if that thought is self, if that thought is nirvana, if that thought is moksha, if that thought is God, any God's name, it is only temporarily coming in our mind, not permanently. It is not continuous. And therefore that thought cannot reveal. Yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. The speech cannot reveal it. The mind aprapya manasaha. Mind cannot comprehend the reality through thoughts. So what it is, what this reality is and what it is not cannot be comprehended by the thought. That is why all great masters try to destroy the Shishya's hold on the world by yena kena prakarena. The purpose of the Guru Maharaj is only if someone is available to destroy their take of the reality of the world. Whatever they are attached to, whatever they are identified with, the Guru Maharaj's attempt is to wean that disciple's mind away from all his attachments and identifications. And sometimes that disciple becomes angry with the Guru Maharaj. It is true. It happens sometimes. But Guru Maharaj, the Guru Tattva within our heart, who is calling us continuously, because of which we are in this satsang, it is His grace. That is why all great masters, here, masters try to destroy the Shishya's hold on the world, but do not allow any other conceptual replacement to be created in its place. This is what the scriptures also do. This is what the masters also do. Initial stages, it is replacement of one concept, tamasic concept, with a rajasic concept with a sattvic concept, a sattvic concept with even a super sattvic concept, then super sattvic concept or total concept, total sattvic concept with the transcendental concept. If initially it is only an idea, a thought, So this is how the Guru Maharaj, Master, scriptures, they wean our mind away from the gross to the subtle, beyond the causal to the total, and from the total intellect off to transcendental. And once this disciple realizes that transcendental as his own essential nature, he is never going to fall back into sattva, rajas, tamas. Because those are only the potential. Then let the mind go through whatever it has to go through. And whatever the mind has to go through, we call that as prarabdha. But the person, the consciousness is not available to it. It is now, instead of becoming identified with only this body, this thought, this mind, it is all that there is. We'll continue from here in our next class. So in this way, when we are reading this text, we are resetting. We are going back to factory settings. We have collected too much data. We have opened too many apps in our mind. Mind is the application. Too many apps we have downloaded. Now we are deleting one by one. This whole text, Amrit Anubhav, is about that only. Shift deleting all your apps. See? So that we can come back to be the original one. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha Harihi Om. Just sit quietly for 30 seconds. Hari Om.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om. Hari Om, Hari Om, Hari Om.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Ha, Hari Om, Laju.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Have a good weekend.
Yes. Thank you. Very beautiful.
Yes, it is. Very.
I have to apply.
Don't see, when you are putting, saying I have to apply, again you are going to put efforts.
That's true.
Listen and be. That's it. Same thing in the meditation also, we did the same thing, isn't it?
Yes.
Yeah. Verse 37.
Hari Om, Swamiji.
Hari Om, Hari Om, Mama. Hari Om.
Hari Om.
Ha, see you. I'll sign out.
Yes.
Thank you.
Bye.
Bye.
Oh.